either of them. Tablet, the Bible app, one, sweet, all right. Go to James chapter 4, verse 14. And then after that, Sister Jessica, we're going to go to Mark 10, 19, okay? Remember, the Bible started tomorrow night at 7 o'clock.
Yeah.
It's going to start on time.
Amen.
Yes. You sure can. Go ahead. Yeah, go ahead. Go for it. I'm still trying to find James.
Peter, James, and John in the cell.
We're going to be studying in 1 Kings 16, 15, 16, 17, around in that area about the life of Elijah. And we're looking to study, determine really, I want to kind of show some methodologies in how to study the Word of God. And one method that we use that I've spoken here about before is called PARDS, P-R-D-S. And it has an acronym, and we put vowels with it, P-A-R-D-E-S. If you want to look it up on Wikipedia, that's what we're going to do tomorrow night. First thing right off the bat, if we're going to look up a way to use PARDS, and it stands for the Peshat, the Ramaz, the Drash, and the Sod. And these are Hebrew words that mean, Peshat means the surface, or the literal meaning of the word, and Ramaz, P-R, the Ramaz means the, it hints at something deeper into the Word of God, like the allegorical, or the parable. When Jesus spoke, he spoke in parables, but those who did not have an ear could not understand what he was saying. His disciples even had to ask him what he was talking about at times, like when the sower went forth to sow some seed. And then the darash is metaphorical, and so when you're talking about a metaphor, it's comparing scripture to scriptures. This is like that, you know, the sunset was like a, I don't know, explosion or something like that, which it shows how to compare word against word. And then the sod is the mystical, or the mysterious things of God, the hidden things of God. And as we begin to study in this manner, I want to use the interlinear Bible. And how many of you know what an interlinear Bible is? Okay, some of y'all do. And it's a translation of the Greek and the Hebrew words that the King James, how many of you know the King James is a version? Amen. It's not the original.
That's right.
It's the one of the first translations, but it was not the original. The original was in Greek and in Hebrew. The Old Testament is in Hebrew, and the New Testament is Greek. How many of y'all knew that? Okay, some of the ones who've been coming to the Bible study. Yeah, that's right. Because this is what we're learning, okay? You're learning about how the Word of God was developed and how and what it really means to us. The Word of God is a mirror that we look into to see who we are in Christ. And this is what we're doing, is we're looking into the Word of God, and we're determining how we can dig and dig out the truths in the Word of God. So we're going to look at Scripture, we're going to go to the interlinear Bible, we're going to study in the Peshat, the literal meaning of what the Scripture is saying. How many of you know what the word Elijah means? It has a meaning. How many of you know, back in the biblical days, that when they named children, they named them with a meaning of why they named them, you know? Moses is drawn out of the water, or drawn out. And Elijah, his name means, my God is Jehovah. And so we see that he was probably not named by his parents, but he was self-named as a proclamation. My God. He made it personal. My God. Oh, here's an interesting fact that I looked up the other day. I hope you don't mind. I'm just going to take one more minute. And so, you know, did the wrong thing. In the book of Malachi, the last book of the Old Testament that goes before the New Testament, there's a scripture that declares, before the great and notable day of the Lord, I will send my prophet Elijah before me. Okay? And we know that John the Baptist came before Christ, and Jesus said unto him, that is the spirit of Elijah. But how many of you know there's another great and notable day of the Lord coming? Amen? All right, so I was thinking about that scripture. I went and looked up the word Elijah and the name Elijah as baby names and popularity. And in 1968, I think it was, the name Elijah was 800th in popularity, 400 to 800, somewhere in that range. 2016, it is the 8th popular name, because God is raising up an army of Elijahs before that great and notable day of the Lord. And I think we can use that as a sign to say Jesus is coming soon, and hopefully before the election. Amen.
Darren, Hey man, I'm trying to find the version of this that I want. I don't have any luck. I'm still looking. Somebody say he's looking. All right. We're going to start with verse 13 instead of verse 14. I think I took the 14. We're starting with verse 13 in James. How many remember when Smarty Pants Doris gave me a little thing that I sprayed as a vapor? Remember? Is it still in there? When Smarty Pants Doris gave me that, to illustrate what a vapor is, okay? And it's just a mist. And it's, you can see it for a second, then it's gone. It just evaporates into the atmosphere. And so we're going to talk about our lives for just a few minutes. And I have done some reflection over the last few weeks, and especially the last couple of days. Reflection, because we're getting ready to roll into 2017, and I'm kind of at a standstill at where we're at as far as building, because we have enough money to get in trouble, but not enough money to finish. And so it's really aggravating me a lot, and it really weighs on my heart a lot, because I just think, God, there's so many things we could do if we were just able to have the place to do them. Amen? And I find myself getting jealous of First Baptist, because First Baptist has so many, and I don't want to get that way, but they have so many facilities and room. And have, you know what I'm saying? And I find myself wanting, and I said, God, forgive me for that. I don't regret or hold back anything that they have. They've earned it. They paid for it. They God blessed them. And I don't want anything, Brother Nick's God. I really don't. I just need room. And it's very, very frustrating to me to be kind of stuck. And so I've just been doing some reflecting in my life in the last few, and some things are going to change in my life. I was on a conference call yesterday with Sherlock Valley, and we were talking about some things. And he's coming again November the 2nd through the 4th. But we're gonna have a time of celebration, a time of today. We were on a conference call with him last night about 9:30, 10:30, somewhere in that area. And he began to speak into us about how the enemy doesn't just come into your life and just automatically cut you off. It begins to wear you down. Wear you down physically, wear you down financially, wears down your marriage, wears down your ministry, and before you know it, you're tired and you don't want to do anything, and you kind of get complacent. Anybody that's ever been in ministry know what I'm talking about. And so what happened is I was on the phone with him, and he began to speak into my life a little bit, and some things I'd already known. Say, listen to me. When somebody comes and gives you a word, it's something that you already know that God confirms in you. Don't just let somebody come and tell you you're going to quit your job and you're going to go to Timbuktu, and thus saith the Lord. If the Lord hasn't spoken to you to quit your job and move to Timbuktu, you need to keep working. And you need to stay put, okay? Just because somebody comes and says, thus saith the Lord, don't mean thus saith the Lord. But if somebody comes with thus saith the Lord and speaks it into your heart, then you can say, thus saith the Lord. Are you with me?
Yeah.
So I began to do some reflecting in my life, and do reflecting in my life. I began to write some things down that I want to see done. I've got to see done, because before I get out of here, I know that my life is just a vapor. I'm almost 48 years old. I'm 47, and in 4 months I'll be 48 years old. And so I want you to think about that. 48. I've been in this church since I was one. Where'd those 47 years go?
Yeah.
Vapor. How many of those days have I wasted? How many of those church services have I wasted? How many of those days have I wasted with other things in my life that allow me to get frustrated with things instead of just doing what God's called me to do?
Amen.
And so I've done a little self-reflection. I unplugged Monday. If you tried to call me Monday, you didn't get hold of me. I only accepted two phone calls, my boss and my wife. Yeah. The two things, Matt Riffle could call me, and Naomi Nance could call me. Because Matt won't call me unless it's an emergency. And Naomi will just call me if she needs something. And those are the two phone calls I accepted Monday. Because I just wanted to unplug, and I didn't work with Cody Monday. I said, I just need to work by myself. Just need to work by myself. Anybody just ever need to work by yourself? Why? I just needed to be alone, me and God and tortillas, man. I just needed to. And Monday was a rough day, man. I just has some fly-by-night, never been in a store in 15 years, come try to take over some of the space, and I was angry. And the Bible says I get angry and sin. Now don't look at me like that. I didn't cuss at the man. I was just mad. But I was a situation. I've been taking care of this store for 15 years. And he just said, oh, here I am. Where's my space? Out in the street. I don't know where your space is. You know, out in the street. And so, anyway, you got to earn it, baby. I earned mine. And so I understand this. So I just had a day of reflecting in my life. And I just begin to, and some things I need to cut off, and some folks I need to cut off, and some things that I just need to get rid of because they do nothing but hold you back from what God's called you to do. Amen. Does that mean you don't love them? No, it don't mean I don't love them. Doesn't mean that you don't, listen, there's some folks that you need to cut off of your life. Maybe you don't. Maybe you need a time of reflection. Unplug on Monday. Work and just listen to what the Lord has to say to you. Pray. Fast. What is God speaking into your life? Man, it's already 7. It's 7:30. It is dark. I hate when it's dark. I like the temperature, but I hate the dark. Amen? So hear me just a second. James 4:13. Sister Jessica, please. Go to now, you just say today or tomorrow we'll go into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain. Whereas you know not what shall be done on the morrow. For what is your life? It is yet even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanisheth away. Yeah. So let me ask you a question this evening, and I'll try to get done with this. I've got 30 minutes because we got to coordinate with our kids and get everybody out of here. So just be patient with me when I say I got 30 minutes. I got 30 minutes. Okay? So I understand. Here's what I want to ask you tonight. What are you going to do with the vapor in your life? What are you going to do with that time that God's given you? Are you just going to sit there and hope that things get better? Yeah. I watched the presidential debate Monday. They don't have the answer. I'll just let you know. Because they won't even answer that question. Those two people don't have the answer. I'll let you know that right now. Neither do their handlers. Neither do their preppers. They don't have the answer. If you're looking for a Democrat or a Republican for an answer to lead you, maybe you're looking in the wrong spot. You better look to a Jesus.
Amen.
You better look to the Savior Party. Yeah. Now, let me just share something with you, because what's going to happen is this. We're going to elect one of them. One of them is going to be elected. He's going to be Madam President or Mr. President. One of the two. Okay? Somebody's going to get elected. And then half the country is going to be mad, half the country is going to be celebrating. Because we're about split as right down the middle as we can be. It's not the north or the south, it's the whatever. Man, it's all over the place. It's just all over the place. Some people are in love with Donald Trump, some people are in love with Hillary. I'm not in love with anyone. I pray that both get saved.
Amen.
And you don't know. Hear me. We will never be here again like we are right now. We will never have the worship like we did tonight ever again. Not the same way. Never. It'll never be the same tomorrow as it is today. Your life tomorrow may be better and may be worse. I don't know. But it will not be the same as it was today. But every day is the same. No, that's not true, man. It's not true. When you walk out of here, you'll not be the same person as when you walked in, physically and hopefully spiritually. Because your cells regenerate at such a clip that whenever you walk out of here, you won't have the same cells as you walked in here with. I looked up vapor, and this is what vapor says. Something unsustainable or transitionary. Diffused matter as a smoke or fog. Suspended floating in the air and impairing its transparency. So I have a question for you. Are you just being a vapor, that you're there for a minute, nobody even notices you, and then you're gone? Are you somebody that hides, that is a, is suspended floating in air, that it impairs the transparency? Are you somebody that impairs the vision? Come on, what do you mean by that, Brother Jeff? Does anybody see you?
Yeah.
Does anybody notice your life? Are you making a difference? Are you standing up for the right? Are you being what God's called you to be? Are you being the light of the world? Are you being the salt? Are you being what God has intended us to be? Are we being the church of Jesus Christ? Or are we being something totally irrelevant?
Amen.
Yeah.
Well, come on now.
Yeah.
Ooh. Are we being irrelevant? What does that mean? That means that nobody notices whether you're there and nobody notices when you left. You're completely irrelevant.
Right.
It doesn't matter if you exist or not. Because you're not making any difference.
Right.
I refuse to live my life that way. Because I don't believe God's called you to live your life that way. I don't believe God's called you to be irrelevant. I believe God's called you to be relevant. I believe God's called you to be something that's in the face of the world to say, I'm going to God. Listen, this is the way to get to heaven. You've got to come this way.
Yeah.
Come on, somebody. Listen, we will never get a chance to sing the songs we sang today the same way we sang them. Don't waste another opportunity. Don't waste another Wednesday night by coming, oh, it's just Wednesday night. No. I know you're tired. I know you work all day. I know. I understand and I get it. But tell your flesh to shut up when I get into the presence of the Lord. I need to be refreshed. God refresh me. We'll never again be in the same anointing as we were in today. Never again. It'll be a different style. It's maybe the same God is anointing you, but it's a different style of anointing. Never again to see our children like they are right now. My children will never be the age again they are right now. They'll never be the same. I don't get to see, listen, my oldest baby will never be a baby any longer. She's almost 20 years old. She'll never be that little red, look like what's the little girl on Brave? Meredith. She'll never look like Meredith. That's what her hair looked like when she was a little girl. She'll look like Meredith. She'll never be that little girl ever again. So did I spend some time with her? Did I get to spend the time that I needed with her and pour into her, that her daddy loves her and that God loves her? Did I get to pour that into her? Did I make a mark in her life?
Amen.
Did I make a mark in Adam's life? He'll never be under 6 feet again. I'll always have to look up to him. It's the truth. Since he was 13 years old, I've had to look up to tell him I will knock his head off. That's the God's honest truth. And I guarantee in his mind, Daddy's taller than he is. Because I will knock the top half of his head off. I will jump up. Because I don't care how old he gets, I want to make a difference in my son's life. Olivia, I almost have to look up to her. Amen? I almost, because listen, I want to make a difference. I want to make a challenge. I want to make a difference in their lives. I want to challenge them. I want them to be better than I've ever been.
Amen.
I want them to have greater than I've ever had. Why? Because I want to make a difference. I want this church to be great, not because my name's on the sign. I want this church to be great because I want us to make a difference. I want us to transform this city. I want us to transform this state. I want us to transform this country and this world. I want to do that, but I can't do it without your help. Listen, we'll never ever again get to inhale the very breath we just exhaled. We never again will get to breathe in the air we just breathed out. Things are changing all the time. In Mark chapter 10, verse 19, and I'll try to get you out of here. I know it's hot, and I apologize. Mark chapter 10, verse 19, says, "Thou knowest the commandments, do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, defraud not, honor thy father and thy mother." Keep going. That may be the wrong verse. And he answered it and said, "Master, all these things have I observed from my youth." One more. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him, and said unto him, "One thing thou lackest. Go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. And come, take up thy cross, and follow me. Take no thought of your life, but take up the thought of the life that I am going to give you. Take no thought of your life, because your life is just a vapor. Your life is here, then it's gone." Is there anybody in here that seems like just last year you were in high school, and now you're 60 and 70, 80 years old, and it seems like last year you should still be in high school? I should still have a mullet. Somebody say amen. I should still have a mullet. I should still have that long tail on my mullet. Come on. Come on, somebody. You should still just now be driving that first car you bought that you wouldn't drive now if someone gave it to you. Come on now. My first car was a Chevrolet Monza, 1978 Chevrolet Monza hatchback two-door. I bought for $750. I said, "I bought." Amen?
Yeah.
$750. Boy, it was a hot rod, I'm going to tell you. But I loved that little red car. Because I paid for it. Then I wrecked that car. Bought a crash Cutlass. 1979 Cutlass Supreme. Had the front grill banded wire to the bumper. Paid $300 for it. Come on, somebody. Seems like just a few years ago I should still be driving the crash Cutlass. Amen. Grew up with a bunch of guys, and nobody had a good car except for Todd. Todd had Camaros, and we always rode Todd, and so we'd ride everywhere 100 miles an hour. But that's true. See how fast we could get to Shawnee. Mom, you don't really listen to it. So we would see if we could beat the time we did last time, Shawnee. And it was still safer than all y'all driving around texting. Come on, somebody. Things are changing all the time. Don't take any thought for your life, because your life is just a vapor. What will your life be? Will your life be meaningless or meaningful? When God opens the books, what will he find? When God opens the books, what will he find? Will he find that you did everything that you could with the Jesus that you had? Will he find us? What did you do with Jesus? What did you do with the Jesus you were given to work with? Yeah. Listen, you're only held accountable for what you know. How can you be held accountable for something you don't know? You have to be accountable for what you know. You should know the word. You should know the truth. You should know the way. You should know the truth. And the truth that you know shall set you free. Oh, Jesus. I'll guarantee you there's a lot of truth in here I don't know. But I'm working on it. I'm trying to find it. And it comes a lack of trying. I'm trying to find some truth because, Brother Dean, the truth that I do know has made me free to this point. But there's some more truth I need to know that'll make me free to another point.
Yeah.
That I don't have to be captive any longer. That I know what God has for my life. And I know how to go forward in my life. And so when I say that I have done some reflection, what I mean is I began to do some inventory of where I'm at and where God has called me to be. And where God has wanted me to be. And I'm not where God wanted me to be. So whose fault is that? God's? No. It's Jeff's fault. So Jeff needs to make some changes. So Jeff unplugged because Jeff wanted to spend some time with God on Monday. And on Tuesday, I didn't answer very many phone calls. And I didn't answer very many today.
Amen.
Why? If it's an emergency, I'll get hold of it. I promise you. I'm not trying to forsake my duties as a pastor. But one of my duties of pastor is to make sure that I'm hearing the word of God and the voice of God. And if you can't do without me for 2 days, I'm going. Listen. What did you do with the Jesus you were given to work with? Did you use him to the best of your ability or simply hope everything would work out? Come on now. Are you just using Jesus and hoping everything will work out? Jesus paid it all. Yeah, I understand that. I get that. Jesus paid it all. He did. He paid it all for me. My salvation, he paid for that. My healing, he paid for that. My prosperity, he paid for that. He paid for everything I need. He got it. I get that. And I got you. I got you. I understand it. I understand that. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Yes, thank you, Jesus. But that don't mean I sit on my tail end and don't do nothing. Amen. Well, you're not saved by your works. Amen. But when I'm saved, I work. Because saved people serve, amen?
Amen.
Found people seek. Come on, somebody. Amen. Saved people serve and found people seek to save somebody else. Come on. Amen. Somebody better understand something today. We've got to change our philosophy the way we think. It ain't about you, and it's not about your problem. It's about somebody is dying and going to hell today, and if we reach anybody today who's going to fall off that cliff, and they're going to fall into an eternity of lake of fire, and we don't really think of it that way.
Right.
Because if we think of it that way, we're going to be able to sleep at night. Okay, I'm going. Do you use him to the best of your ability? Or you simply hope everything's going to work out? When it's over, it's over. When we're done, we're done. When this service is over, this service is over. We can never go back to this one. You better help me. As much as it pains me, I'll never be 25 again. I'll never be 25 again. I'm feeling pretty good. But I'll never be 25 again. I'll never watch my children take their first steps again. Never. Never. You'll never be back there again. So what you gonna do with what you got left? Come on now. Come on now. This young man, his father was killed yesterday. Yesterday? Yesterday. 60 years old. Hit by a car. He was working on his truck over at Earlsboro. 19-year-old girl is texting and they're hitting. Her life is never going to be the same. This young man's life is never going to be the same. 19 years old. Hit him. Killed him. I'm sorry, Trent. I know you were coming in. Sorry. Trent's been coming to this church for about a long time, 6-7 years. He's a little kid, he started coming. He's a big man now, but he's a little kid, he started coming. Lost his daddy yesterday. 60. 60 gets a lot younger all the time. I'm 13 years from 60, actually 12 years and 4 months from 6 months. I remember when I started my IRA account. I said, you can't touch it for 16 years. And I thought, well, that's a dumb number. Why can't I touch it for 16 years? I said, why can't I touch it for 16 years? Oh, that's when you'll be 58. I said, oh, no. No. That hurt me. That made it quick. That made it real to me. I was 42 years old. That made it come to life. 16 years. I thought, well, that was some kind of government stupid date. I couldn't think. No. You'll be 58 years old. I said, oh, Jesus, I got to get busy. I got to get busy doing something. I mean, I got to get busy. But I'll never get to watch my children take their first steps again, which was amazing. I'll never forget it. It's amazing to watch all four of them take their very first steps. I remember Ava's like this tall and she started walking. She was like 10 months old. She started walking and I remember we were, Donald's not here tonight, but we were in the fellowship hall and she's, She walked the dog, and the dog said, "Hey, when did that happen?" And I said, "Man, she just got up one day and decided she was going to walk, and she started walking. And she did it. I watched Adam walk. I watched David, Olivia, Abby. I'll never get that again. So what are you going to do with your time that you have left? How much time do you have left? I don't know. A baseball player and two of his friends got killed, 24, 23, and 26 years old. They hit a jetty off the coast in Miami, and their boat killed instantly. They had everything in the world. And everything in the world, all the world, you think, and listen, I pray that the young man was right with God. I don't know. I don't know his life. I don't know anything about him. Other than he was 24 years old and lost his life. I looked in the newspaper yesterday and a young man, 13 years old, died. And a 13, little Indian boy, 13 years old. And 13. What are you going to do with the time you have left? Are you going to worry about everything else? Are you going to do what God says to? These moments in time are over forever. We don't have the luxury of wasting time that God's given us. And listen to me, please. Give me 8 minutes and I promise I'll tell you this. I don't have the luxury of wasting time any longer. I feel like I've wasted some time this year. I feel like I've kind of just wasted some of the things that God's asked me to do. And I feel like I've wasted some time, but I don't have that luxury any longer. Listen, are we wasting the time that God gave us to do ministry? Are we wasting the time that God gave us to worship? Are we wasting the time that God gave us to get things right in God's house? We can't waste the time that God's given us with our families and with each other with stupid arguments over stupid things.
Amen.
Can you really look at your life and say, "I'm glad I had that argument"? I know things happen. There are some good arguments. I'm not saying there's not. But most of them aren't. Most of them are over silliness, immaturity, pettiness. And that's just the church. I ain't talking about your family. Most things don't matter here or means. Most things wouldn't matter if you come back next year and say, "Well, because this and that," you'd think this was the dumbest thing I've ever been mad about. If you take the time and write down your grievance while you're really mad, you would say, "I'm not turning that in. That's stupid. That's the dumbest thing." When you look at it and you read it and not just react to it, you really have time to waste on each other and your families. Listen, there may not be a tomorrow. Now, I have a future. You have a future. Just you wait and see. You do have a tomorrow. Now, I know the Bible says that tomorrow is not promised to any man. I understand that. I'm not trying to contradict the Bible. What I'm saying is this. You'll need to spend tomorrow in heaven or hell or here. You'll need to spend tomorrow in eternity or here. So you will have a tomorrow. It just depends on what your tomorrow looks like. There may not be a tomorrow to do with what God's called you to do. But there's a today. Oh, come on. There's a right now. God willing, you get up in the morning. God willing, you'll eat breakfast in the morning. God willing, you'll go to work tomorrow. God willing, you'll make enough money to support your family. God willing. And understand that if God comes, Jesus comes right now, where are you going to spend eternity? This life is but a vapor, quickly gone, never to be seen again. What will you do with yours? I heard this story, and I know many of you have heard the same story, about it's not about the date when you're born, and then it's not about the date that you die. It's about the dash between the two. What did you do with your dash? That length of time, what did you do with it? What did you do with it? I don't want to waste any longer. I need more time. I don't want to waste any more time on silliness. I don't want to waste any more time on things that don't matter. Hill of beans. You know, beans don't mean much. Listen, they're your beans, but still understand me that I don't want you to get all upset and all fired up about something that really shouldn't be so distracting to you. Because what the devil does, come on somebody, what the devil does is he distracts you from every situation and he makes you so angry about something that doesn't matter that you can't even focus on God. Much less a lost sinner, somebody that's out there that you need to reach for God. And so the church is in such turmoil because we're all messed up and we're all jacked up about what somebody did in 1972 that we can't even get on with our lives. Come on now. I promise you that what happened in 1972 ain't so important anymore. Most of those folks dead. Amen? The folks that you've been mad at for 40 years are either in the nursing home or dead. Come on. Let it go. Let it go. Come on. We gotta understand, you know, we gotta understand that we got some things we gotta get done. And hanging on to nonsense is not getting stuff done.
Amen.
That's not getting stuff done. So my question to you tonight is this: what will you do with your vapor? What will you do? You seen those folks that vape? They're like the whole car's on fire. Yeah. Don't roll your eyes at me. You seen that? Good Lord. Look like Cheech and Chong looking at that thing. For you young folks, this movie's about dope. Okay. But that's what it looks like. So your vapor gonna fill up the car, or just you gonna be a little? Fill the world up, man. Let's do what God's called us to be. Let's do what God's called us to do. Let's make a difference. Let's make a difference. Let this church make a difference. You ready to make a difference?
Yes.
Good. You know why? Because Sunday, October the 2nd, this Sunday, is life change. That's life change, brother. I'm so glad you're here. From 2 o'clock to 3:30, we'll be standing on the highway, SNL Diner, and it's Subway across, all the way down there, holding signs, being silent and holding signs about anti-abortion signs, standing up for those who can't stand up for themselves. If you would like to be part of it, we're going to meet at SNL Diner at 2 o'clock. Margo called me today and she said, would you please announce it? Would you please announce it? I said, Margo, I'll do it for you. This is Margo Timms. This is her thing, man. And I'll help her and I'll support her. The last few years, we've had more people there than anybody. Well, okay? I'm getting like it or not. Listen, I'm anti-abortion guy. I mean, I'm not here. If you've had one, I'm not going to beat you up. God forgives sin. Man, I'm not. The deal of sin, cast the first stone. That's not me. Don't worry about it. Forgive yourself. Forgive like God be forgiven. I will forgive you. Forgive yourself. Walk on. Amen? Walk on. Don't beat yourself up. I'm going to do my very best to make sure some young lady knows there's a difference in change. There's something else you can do. Come on. I'll do my best. Let them know that God loves them no matter what. I don't care if they got pregnant and they're not married. God still loves them. Is that the best way to think things? No. Is that the righteous thing to do? No. But please, you don't take a life for it. Well, that's controversial. I don't know why. Life is precious. It's a vapor. What are you going to do with yours? Come on, y'all even know how to react to that anymore. Y'all not used to people saying the truth. Can you say that in church? Yeah? Yeah? I can stay in the church. Let's just do the best we can do. Let's do the best we can do. Listen, there's young folks that don't know. There's another, they don't know. scared, then, no. I just need some help. They need somebody to love them. They need somebody to love them. I'm the next. Man, it's going to be all right. It's okay. God don't hate you. They love you. I'm tired of people beating up people. It's like God hates everybody. God don't hate you. My God, he died to be with you. What he did, Jesus died to be inside of you. He loves you. He wants to be with you. He wants to walk in you. You're the temple of the Holy Ghost. My Bible tells me that God dwells in the temple, doesn't he?
Yes.
Come on, somebody.
Yes.
So you really think that he hates? No. We just need to get some things right in our lives.
Amen.
I don't know if I'm in the right church or not. Listen, October the 2nd, this Sunday at 2 o'clock, we're going to meet at S&I Diner, hold up signs. People are hog and wave at you. Some people are not going to be as nice. That's okay. Just be prepared. We stand there. It's going to be hot. You're going to get a sign. If you want to work at shifts and you stand 30 minutes, let somebody else come in, whatever you need to do. I don't want anybody passing out. If you need a chair, take your folding chair, sit it out there by the road. Now be careful. Get off the road. I mean, we're not sitting right there by the line. Come on, somebody. We're going to walk the road. God didn't call us to be stupid. Okay?
Yeah.
He called us to be wise and servants and fill his doves, right?
Yes.
Okay. Harmless. Okay. So understand. October 2nd, this Sunday, is another day I won't get a nap on a Sunday. Amen? Yeah, that's all right. We're going to go. We're going to have a good time with the Lord. Let's make a difference. Can we make a difference in somebody's life? Can we do that? Can we do that?
Yes.
I think we can do that. I know you can do that. God loves you. Stand to your feet. I lied to you. I kept you 2 minutes over.